Hi folks, Rajesh Gobina this side. Thank you so much for the great support you're extending to my videos. And again, we have completely covered about the lighting, and again, we have already started a new series which is talking about the camera. In my last episode, if you remember it right, in my previous video about the camera, we have discussed about a brief history about the camera. Also, we have discussed about the components of the camera, and also we have discussed about how a camera functions. Now let's talk about the new series, which will be talking about the different types of camera. As it is about the differences of camera, I would broadly segregate this video into two parts. One will be talking about the image capturing technology of a camera. The other one will be the structural technology of the camera. When I say about the image capturing technology, it is all about pixels, megapixels, sensors, and sensor size. So you might have heard all these words very frequently. You might have understood that, okay, more the megapixel inside a camera, the more the picture quality. Is it true or is it false? Is the mobile phone companies trying to fool around by saying more the megapixel, more the picture quality? Let us understand in detail about that. And again, what is the sensor? What is the sensor size? And also let us understand what is the correlation between the megapixels and the sensor size. So we will be completely understanding about the different type of camera right from the mobile phone. We'll be understanding about the point and shoot camera, then the crop sensor camera, full frame cameras, and finally the legendary medium format cameras. And in the structural technology, we will be quickly going and understanding what is the old age film camera structure versus the DSLR, and what does DSLR stands for. And quickly we'll be moving on to the latest technology, which is talking all about the mirrorless cameras. So let's begin the episode now. So let's try to understand what is the image capturing technology and what are the different types of technologies. Okay. So let's start from the basics. What is a pixel? You might have definitely heard about the term megapixel. You might have also understood that more the megapixel, the picture quality is definitely more. Okay, so let us understand what is a pixel. A pixel is a tiny dot or a square of color, which is a part of a digital image. A digital image typically consists of millions of such small dots or small pixels. And all these pixels will be captured different color range, different colors, different intensity of color, different color variations, etc., etc. The word pixel is a combination of two words, which is picture and elements, which has combined to make it pixel. And let us quickly understand what is a megapixel. A megapixel is 1 million of pixel, or in other words, 10 lakhs of pixel form a megapixel. Let us go and check how the pixels are formed in a digital image. As we all know, once the photographer presses or clicks the shutter release button, the light directly comes into the camera and hits the image sensor. The image sensor of a camera is having millions of cavities or light capturing wells, which is called as photosites. And when the light is hitting the photosites of this image sensor inside a digital camera, it hits at the different color variations, color combinations, and different color patterns, etc., etc. And when the processor inside the digital camera does its job, the digital image is created, and the tiniest or the smallest element of a digital picture is the pixel. And we were discussing about 1 million pixels makes 1 megapixel. So what do you think? More the megapixel, more the image quality, right? Sounds fair, sounds logical. And again, that is kind of true also. So more the megapixel a camera can offer or a mobile phone can offer, the picture quality will be much better. Before concluding to the image quality, we have to consider one more factor which decides the quality of an image, which is the size of the image sensor. We will quickly run through the different sizes of image sensors, and we will try to figure out which image sensor is fixed into what kind of camera. Also, we will try to figure out the relationship between the pixels and the size of the sensor. And put together, we will try to understand what makes the better quality image. As we have discussed about the pixels and the megapixels, now let us discuss about the size of the image sensor. As we already spoke, the PhotoSight captures the light and give it to the process for the image processing. Now in this case, let us compare two image sensors, one on a larger size, one on a smaller size. One with 20 megapixel, the other also with 20 megapixel. Let's compare it. So, the number of PhotoSights required to create a 20 megapixel image, irrespective of the size of the sensor, is the same. Which means, the number of PhotoSights on both the sensors are the same. So, which translates to, if the same number of PhotoSights has to be placed on a smaller sensor size, what is the option? We have to reduce the size of PhotoSights. Then only it will fix properly in the image sensor. So what is the impact in that? Let us take one single PhotoSight. The larger the PhotoSight, it will be able to capture more area of light, more variations of light, more dynamic range of light. As the size is bigger, the sensitivity also will be bigger. So it will be able to capture much better quality light from a low light situations also. It can control all kind of digital noise also. Obviously, when we reproduce the image as a digital image, the picture will be of much better quality. So to conclude, a larger digital image sensor will perform better than a smaller digital sensor in terms of dynamic range. It will perform much better in terms of low light situations. It will perform much better in terms of noise reductions and so on and so forth. I am sure that most of you might have got an idea about what is a pixel, what is megapixel image sensor, and how does the larger image sensor fare against the sibling of the smaller size, even though at the same image resolution. Let me make it more precise to you, the advantage of having a larger image sensor. The first and the most important thing, the scalability of the image. If we shoot with a camera which is having a smaller image sensor, the image cannot be scaled after a certain extent and the image will start pixelating, or rather it will crack, the image will crack. So, but instead of that, if you're shooting that kind of an image with a camera which is having a larger image sensor, the scalability is much better. And when we see all the hoardings across the city, like 50 feet hoarding or 100 feet hoarding, it's all captured from those camera which is having the larger image sensor size. So it's very important to know about it. And the next quality is definitely the dynamic range, the high dynamic range. By the way, what is a dynamic range? The dynamic range is the difference between the highlights and the shadows in the image. When we say it's higher dynamic range, there will be a lot of color variations from highlight to shadows. So if it is on a larger image sensor, the sensor will be able to capture more dynamic range into the picture because the pixel size is much larger. The picture will be definitely looking beautiful. And the third quality of having a larger image sensor is the low light performance. Have you ever shot with a mobile after 7 o'clock or after 8 o'clock where the light is so low, and if you zoom out the image, you can see the picture started showing a lot of noise or grains? That is because the image sensor in a mobile phone is much lower compared to a DSLR. If you shoot the same picture with the same resolution DSLR or a mirrorless camera, you will not recognize that kind of a noise because the image sensor is higher and the performance of low light capturing with a higher image sensor is much better and it will not give that kind of a noise. And one other important point is color reproduction. If you are capturing an image with a larger sensor size, each and every PhotoSight inside the image sensor will be capturing much more details of color, much more variations of color. For example, if you're talking about a black and white image, from black to white, if the normal smaller image sensor may be capturing only 50 shades of gray, but a larger image sensor may be capturing 255 shades of gray plus white and black. So that's a huge difference. And when it comes to commercial photography or professional photography, that makes a lot of difference because the actual and accurate color reproduction is much required when you're shooting for a designer or maybe when you're shooting for a campaign which is talking about the colors. So as we know, the larger the image sensor, the better the picture quality will be. Now let's see a real case study, and again let's understand what is the size of an image sensor which is fixed into your regularly used mobile phone, and how does it differ from and how does it fare to a DSLR or a mirrorless camera, and how does it compare to a medium format camera. Let's see that. Please go through this diagram. It will make a very clear understanding to you. If you go through the top of the diagram, you can see the name of the sensor. So you can see the full frame, APS-C format or crop format, so on and so forth. The next column is the relative size of the sensor. For example, what is the size of a sensor which full frame cameras are having, and what is the size of APS-C sensor or maybe crop sensor, and right away, right, and towards the right, what is the size of the mobile phone sensor also. And the size is also mentioned in the next column, and again camera type is also mentioned. What are the examples of the different type of camera and what are the examples of cameras is also mentioned in the next column. So if we start from the mobile phones, the earlier mobile phones, which was Apple iPhone 5, was having a image sensor size of 4.4 into 3.3 millimeter square, which was too small when it is comparing to the next level of camera, which is a point and shoot camera. By the way, what is a point and shoot camera? Point and shoot makes your lives very easy. So it's not a very complicated device. The lens cannot be changed. It's always very compact, slim and small. So you can put it in your pocket and you can take it anywhere where you go. And you can, whenever you want to shoot, just take it out, just switch on, the lens will be out, and you can do just, no need to focus, no need to do anything. There, everything will be automated and automatic. You can just keep shooting. That's why it's just point and shoot. And the sensor size of all these point and shoot cameras were 6.1 into 4.6 millimeter square, which is slightly bigger than the old age iPhones. Next, let's talk about the high-end compacts or the bridge cameras. So what's a bridge camera? It is a bridge between the point and shoot camera to the DSLR cameras or the mirrorless cameras. It falls somewhere in between. So all these bridge cameras can shoot amazing pictures. They can shoot in RAW, they can shoot in so many manual modes and everything. But yes, what makes it more resembling to the point and shoot cameras that this, the lenses are not changeable. In DSLR or a mirrorless camera, the lenses are changeable, but here the lenses are not changeable. And most of the time, the sensor size is 7.6 into 5.7 millimeter square, which was much bigger than the low mid compacts or the point and shoot camera. Now let's understand the iPhones and the mobile phones has advanced a lot way from 4.4 into 3.3 millimeter square. Now the latest iPhones are having the image sensor size of 7 into 5.8 millimeter square, which is as good as a bridge camera or a high-end compact camera. The mobile phones has advanced a lot. Next, let us go to the mid-range and entry-level DSLRs, which is having an APS-C sensor, or otherwise it is called a crop sensor. The sensor size is much bigger than any of the mobile phones and any of the other bridge cameras or anything. It is having an image sensor of 24 into 16 millimeter square, which is practically quite larger than any of the mobile phones. And if you want to know what are the examples of the crop sensor camera, it is Canon 70D, Canon 60D, Canon 80D, Canon 90D, Canon 7D. All these cameras come into the category of APS-C sensor or crop sensor cameras. Now let's move to the higher end DSLRs, or maybe you can call full frame cameras, which is mostly used in all the commercial shoots. All the full frame cameras are having a 36 into 24 millimeter square image sensor, which is literally huge, and the sensor size of the full frame cameras are equivalent to the old days 35mm film camera. And there is one more different type of camera which you may not be very familiar with, but most of the commercial photographer, and if you have worked with commercial projects, so definitely you will be knowing about it. It is a medium format camera. Medium format camera is having a mighty 54 into 40 millimeter square size of image sensor, which is gigantic in size. So that if you look at any of the hoardings, if you look at any of the billboards which is placed in across the city, most of the time such photographs will be taken in medium format cameras. And the medium format cameras and the brand names of medium format cameras, if you're familiar with it, is Hasselblad's, Then Phase 1, Mamiya, Pentax is also having a medium format. Fuji also has launched a medium format camera. These are the medium format camera, which is actually used for commercial photography only. It cannot be used for any kind of candid photography or casual photography. It is proper commercial higher-end cameras. To conclude, how does mobile phone fare with the DSLR cameras or the medium format cameras? Yes, the mobile phone cameras are pretty good for a casual shoot or a random shoot, or maybe if you don't want to scale the image to a huge size, if you are not very keen about the noise, or if you are not very keen about the actual color reproduction or the dynamic ranges, mobile phone does a fairly good job. But yes, once you move into a professional category of photography, so obviously mobile phone cannot function over there. There we need the real professional cameras, which starts from full frame cameras or medium format cameras. Now let's discuss about the structural differentiators in a camera. The first structural difference, if you talk about the old age cameras and the current age cameras, are the earlier the images were captured in a film and now it is a sensor. That's because structural change which brought into the camera. And the second point is, have you ever thought about what is SLR? Why is it called SLR? Why is it called DSLR? And what is mirrorless? It's a very important point to know. What is SLR? SLR camera means single lens reflex camera. And what is that? If you have watched my previous video on the components of the camera and how does camera function, you might have understood that a lens which is fixed to a camera has two purposes. The first one is to ensure the light is passing through the lens and going to a sensor and the image is being captured. And the second purpose is, while the light is entering into the camera through the lens, there is a mirror which has been kept at a 45 degree angle, and the light hits on the mirror, reflects upward, goes through the pentaprism, which is a mechanism which is kept inside the camera, and it passes through the viewfinder for a photographer to see the real-time image. As there is only one single lens doing both the purposes, it is called single lens reflex, SLR. Obviously, SLR camera means single lens reflex camera. You may have a doubt, was there any camera with two lenses? Yes, there was cameras which was having two different lenses. One lens will ensure the image is being captured, the other lens will ensure the image is seen properly through the viewfinder by the photographer. And when comparing to this dual lens setup, SLR had only one single lens, and that is called a single lens reflex camera. And what is DSLR? D is very simple, it's for D for digital. So digital single lens reflex camera, that is a DSLR. Of late, if you have noticed in the industry, there is a new entrant called mirrorless camera. So what is a mirrorless camera? As we were discussing, in the DSLR, there was a mirror which was reflecting the light through the pentaprism and the viewfinder for the photographer to see the proper image. In mirrorless, there is no mirror at all. Then how is it doing the job? In the DSLR, the viewfinder through which the photographer sees the image, it was an optical viewfinder, which means it is all through glasses, like one mirror is hitting, another one is pentaprism, it's again a glass, viewfinder is again a glass, that's it's called an optical viewfinder. And in the mirrorless camera, while the light is entering through the lens, there is a lot of electronic setup which has been done already inside the mirrorless camera, which will convert the image into the viewfinder, which is electronic viewfinder, which functions completely based on electronics. So the mirrorless cameras has brought a lot of changes into the industry. First of all, the camera size has drastically reduced. And second of all, the biggest advantage of mirrorless camera over DSLR is, okay, the mirrorless camera's electronic viewfinder give a real-time picture even before clicking the image. But in a DSLR, the photographer has to assume certain calculations and he has to click the picture. And if he want to see the result, he has to look at the display which is coming on the rear side of the camera. These are the structural differentiators in the camera. We have discussed about the analog cameras which are recording the image in a film, and later the digital cameras which is recording in image sensors. Then we have discussed about what is SLR, what is DSLR, and what is mirrorless cameras. And that's all for today. Thank you so much for watching this video. Please like this video, please subscribe my channel, please share this video. That will be great motivation for me to bring out a lot of new informative and interesting videos which will help you to learn a lot about photography and the language what photographer talks. This will definitely help your performance as a model, as a hair artist or a makeup artist or anybody who is working in an entertainment industry. So thank you so much. Stay blessed, stay safe.